I am R. Radhakrishnan, Associate Professor in Ahmed University, and I am taking a course, GME, that is Graduate Mechanical Engineer course, 1 year course, and I am a faculty on that. And today I would like to talk about the basic things of watchkeeping. See, if you initially the watchkeeping, how it came into force, that we have to see. Actually, lot of accidents were taking place and there was no standardization and there was no proper training, not certification, nothing was like that. So IMO realized this one and they said, no, we have to do something about this. And then they formed STCW convention called 95. In that they said, we must have standard training certification for watchkeeping. It was a convention ratified by all the countries, all the 172 countries, and it came into force in 1995, mainly because it was not properly done and many accidents were proved that improper watches were taking place. So watchkeeping is a core duty not only for engine crew, it is also for the bridge. Bridge is the main watchkeeping because 24 hours the bridges are always man. At least in the engine room, we have we can switch over to UMS condition, that is called unattended machinery space. Unattended machinery space, UMS space, which is the option for only for engineers, not for the ship people. Ship people, even deck people, mainly think they have to, you know, keep a watch continuously 24 hours because the whole ship will be in trouble if the bridge is not getting proper action at that moment. So we will see about mainly in watchkeeping, engine room watchkeeping duties. Ship is divided into three distinct parts. One is cargo carrying holds and tanks, the accommodation and the machinery space in engine room. And all of them are regularly watched. The tank holds and all are also watched. The accommodation is also regularly checked. And the engine room, of course, is on watchkeeping also. The term watch is used to mean either a group of personnel composing the watch or period of responsibility for an engineer officer during which his physical presence in the machinery space may or may not be required. So this is actually why the SA may or may not be required, because the engine room especially can be made as unattended machinery space. That is why they said may or may not be required. But it's the whole and sole authority of the chief engineer. If he finds something wrong, he can always put the engine room on watchkeeping. That is his prerogative right. Normally, in the engine room, we have many persons like chief engineer, second engineer, who is heading the engine department, third engineer, fourth engineer, junior engineer, and electrical officer. Slowly, they removed this electrical officer and they said, no, electro-technological officer. ETO, Electro-Technical Officer. So they now, the ETO is having a certification also, and they are also having an important role in the ship. Others are all called Petty Officer, only one fitter is called Petty Officer, and the rest of them are all called ratings. Either there will be two motormen or three motormen, and one wiper or two wiper according to the ship type and ship, these managing authorities. So ERR is called engine room rating, ERR, maybe two person or one person, oilers, fitter, all these are all comprises of the engine room personnel. Our aim is now talking about engine room watchkeeping only, so I am going to concentrate on engine room personnel and engine room watchkeeping system. So normally watchkeeping system, actually, you know, if you see in the ship, if the ship is not automated, then automatically the classical society will give the ship manned condition. In that case, minimum manning certificate will come according to the, all these are all under regulation. Now, nobody can say I cannot do this and all because there is a regulation is there. So regulation, always we have to follow the regulation. It's something like obeying the law. If you don't obey the law, you are penalized. So minimum manning is given only for automated ship And if it is as per the automated ship, you can have two officers, one chief engineer, two watermen, like that. But if it is not having any automation, then proper watchkeeping, that is three watchkeepers should be there. So that is what we are going to see now. And these watchkeeping hours are 4 hours on and 8 hours off. In the watchkeeping hours also, now there is a rest hour has come as per the SPCW Manila Convention 2010. There is a rest hours are very, very important. So you need to have minimum 3% to keep watch. So you will have second engineer keeping one watch, third engineer keeping one watch, fourth engineer keeping one watch. All of them are certified engineers. All of them are certified engineers given by the government of India or some other UK or Australia or something like that. They have certified engineers for keeping watch. So second engineer will keep morning 4 to 8 watch, fourth engineer will keep 8 to 12 watch, but actually chief engineer will be supervising the fourth engineer, and third engineer will keep the midnight watch, 24 watch, and 8 hours off. So automatically they will have 8 hours off, 8 hours rest will be there as per the rest hour requirements. Similarly, on the deck also, it is given as second officer, chief officer, third officer. 00 to 04 is second officer on the deck, that is on the bridge. 04 to 08 is chief officer, and 08 is 12 hours is third officer. After 8 hours, it will become 16 to 20, and then 20 to 24, and 24 to 04. This is for fitness for duty as per the STCW9 convention. This is a ratified convention, like Solace, Marpol. The STCW convention is ratified. Now 2010 also has come. In the Manila conference, they have ratified it and it has come more. All persons inside the watch shall be provided a minimum of 10 hours of rest in 24 hours period. You cannot just tell them to work continuously. So 10 hours of rest is required for 24 hours period. The hours of rest may be divided into no more than two periods, one of which shall be at least 6 hours in length. Now whatever we are seeing is according to the STCW Convention 95, and there is a slight modification in these things in 2010. I will go through that also afterwards. The requirements for rest periods of the above need not be maintained in case of an emergency or drill or in other overriding operational conditions. Of course, they specify these, and the overriding authority has got, the master has got the overriding authority according to the situation awareness, like any emergency, that anything such as put the ship into danger, then master can override and need not follow the rest hour policy. Minimum period of 10 hours may be reduced to not less than 6 consecutive hours, provided that any such reduction shall not extend beyond 2 days, and not less than 70 hours of rest are provided each 7 day period. So ultimately in a week, 70 hours is the rest hours. As per the STCW Convention 95. So fitness for duty, the convention was ratified in Manila in 2010. So minimum of 10 hours of rest in any 24 hours period continues to be there, and 77 hours in any 7 day period. The previous was 70 hours, now this is 77 hours in any 7 day period. The hours of rest may be divided into no more than two periods, of which shall be at least 6 hours in length, and the intervals between the consecutive periods of rest shall not exceed 14 hours. The requirements of the above need not be maintained same in the case of emergency or in other overriding operational conditions. Musters for fighting lifeboat drills and drills prescribed by national laws and regulations and by international instruments shall be conducted in a manner that minimizes the disturbance of the rest periods and does not induce fatigue. Actually, what in this fourth one is meaning is, you can't conduct drills and training in the rest period and say that we are conducting training, and so it in the rest hours need not be done. So drills and all this training are all done in the working hours, not in the rest hours. If a person is pulled out from the rest hours, then he should be adequately compensated. That is the work of captain and chief engineer. Suppose if somebody is keeping watch 24 watch and 3 o'clock they wanted to do, 5 o'clock they want to do the what, then you have to follow the additional requirement. Watch schedules be posted where they are easily accessible, maintained in a standardized format in the working language of the ship and in English. Normally the working language of the ship is English, and there is a format is there. In the format, you have to put the schedule of the watch keeping hours, who is doing watch, and it will be kept in the accessible places. Accessible places means either in the alleyway near the smoke room, or in the smoke room itself, or in the dining room itself. But it will be kept in the engine room and bridge. These watch keeping schedules will be signed by the chief engineer as well as by master, and posted in the bridge as well as in the engine room. That is very important, because nowadays most of the routine inspection or post-check control, they come and check only that one, whether the schedules are all posted and whether it is being followed, rest of us is followed. The rest of us are all nowadays maintained by a software technique where the individual person will be entering the working hours. So thereby, if he is exceeding the working hours, then he can be told not to do that way and can be applied. Or adequate information will be written in that, saying that it was an emergency and chief has given permission or master has given permission. So it is an individual responsibility to see the rest of us of himself while working, apart from the scheduled work, first keeping hours. When a seafarer is on call, such as when missionary space is unattended, the seafarer shall have an adequate compensatory rest period if the normal period of rest is disturbed by call outs to work. This is, I have to explain, because if you are an unmanned condition, that is engine room is unmanned, then during the unmanning hours, if any alarm comes, and if the alarm is attended by the duty engineer, then he should be adequately compensated by rest hour. This means, suppose a third engine is keeping watch, is keeping now. Whenever there is an unmanned condition, then everybody is not working in watch keeping. So everybody will come together at 8 o'clock, they will do the work, and then they may knock off at 5 o'clock in the evening. In the evening, when they knock off, they unman the engine room. So, and then while unmanning, they will put it in third engineer room. So third engine is on watch keeping. So everything is going smooth, but suddenly around 12 o'clock or 1 o'clock, if he is getting alarm, so he has to come down, of course, by informing the bridge and taking all personal safety, he will come down and attend the engine room alarm. In case he attend the engine room alarm at 1 o'clock, he need to have a minimum of 6 hours continuous sleep. So up to 7 o'clock, he cannot be disturbed. Suppose the alarm comes at 4 o'clock in the morning, then if he cannot be disturbed at 8 o'clock, he will be disturbed only at 10 o'clock. So he will have 2 hours extra sleep in the daytime. So he will be coming only at 10 o'clock. Accordingly, he will write in the notice board that I attended so-and-so alarm and I was here up to 5 o'clock attending the problem. So I will come at 10 o'clock. Something like that he will write in. So this is what it is telling about it, the seafarer call. Such as when missionary space is unattended, the seafarer shall have an adequate compensatory rest period if the normal period of rest is disturbed by call outs to work. So with this, I will end up this topic of watchkeeping, and we will further proceed next time. Thank you very much.